know who's in there.
Honoured guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the installation of the 13th Bishop of Rockhampton. It's my privilege to lead us today, and it's a great honour. Please switch off your mobile phones if you haven't already done so. If you need water, there is plenty of water at the entrance to the cathedral. If you need the loos, through to your right, the next building on the entranceway there. We are operating under COVID safe restrictions, as you all know, so please remember your social distancing and all of those kinds of things. Finally, welcome to all those who are watching this online, particularly the many people who would have loved to have been here from the local churches. We have are fully booked out and at the maximum number of the number of people that we are allowed in the building. So may the Lord be with you.
All of us here today, at one time or other, have moved to Central Queensland and began a relationship with a local Anglican church in the Diocese of Rockhampton. Your move to CQ may have been recent, like our soon-to-be-installed bishop, or it may have been a number of generations ago. However long you have been here, the time is insignificant compared to the Aboriginal peoples and their nations, who have been in Central Queensland for many tens of thousands of years. As the Rockhampton Diocese Aboriginal representative on the National Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Anglican Committee, and on behalf of the Aboriginal nations in our diocese from beyond Winton, where the Kaua people of the Yirrandali language group, to our beautiful coastal land and Great Keppel Islands, under the care of the Wapabara and the Darumbal, I welcome you and your family to Central Queensland country. As Anglican Christians, with a stewardship responsibility for God's creation, we recognise and thank the Aboriginal people, the First Nations, the traditional caretakers. Our Anglican family acknowledge and respect the continued custodianship of this country by the Aboriginal nations in our diocese.
Please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we have come together as the Church of God to fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, to encourage one another to hold fast to the hope that Jesus has given us, and to spur on one another onto love and good deeds. Specifically, we gather to install and welcome our new bishop as he takes his place as servant and shepherd among us. Let us pray. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, by your infinite love and goodness, you have given us your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and the author of eternal life. After he had ascended into heaven, he poured forth the abundant gifts of the Holy Spirit, making some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, all for the building up of his holy church, the body of Christ. Grant, Lord, to your servant Peter, that he may always be ready to proclaim the good news of salvation and reconciliation. May he be wise and faithful steward of your grace and love, to the glory of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. Open the doors.
Archdeacon Tom, and the people of the Diocese of Rockhampton, we bring to you our brother Christ, Bishop Peter. We thank God for his ministry across our nation. He was duly consecrated on Wednesday at St. John's Cathedral, Brisbane. we bring him to you and pray that our sisters and brothers in Christ in the Diocese of Rockhampton will love and support Ethan in fulfilling God's call to this diocese.
I, Peter John Grice, by the providence of God, elected Bishop of Rockhampton, come to take my place in the Cathedral Church of St. I ask for you, the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, will equip me with everything good that I may do his will, working in me that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen.
Bishop Peter, we gladly welcome you in the name of the Lord. We have been praying for you, and we shall continue to pray for you, asking our merciful God to grant you humility and a servant's heart, so that with one mind and with one voice, we may together, as the people of this diocese, glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. To wait until Peter and the presenters were actually in the cathedral to officially welcome our honoured guests. It's our great pleasure to welcome here today Ms. Brittley Lorger, who is the state member for Keppel and the Assistant Minister for Education. Senator Matt Canavan, Senator for Queensland and Deputy Leader of the National Party of the Senate. The Honourable Michelle Landry, Federal Member for Capricornia, Mayor Andrew Ireland, Mayor of the Livingston Shire Council. We also, of course, welcome our Provincial Archbishop, Archbishop Philip Aspinall. Thank you for doubling up as well on Wednesday night and flying up here. We also welcome from the Catholic Church, Bishop Michael McCarthy, the Bishop of the Catholic Diocese of Rockhampton. Very quickly, there are a number of other bishops that have travelled great distance to be here. So we welcome Bishops Gary Nelson from Western Australia, Bishop Greg Anderson from the Northern Territory, Bishop Carol Wagner is from the Diocese of Canberra-Goulburn, who was also about to become my next door neighbour. So thank you, Carol. We also send apologies from Bishop Keith in the North Queensland, and we welcome the very Reverend Kenneth Lay, the Dean of the Cathedral in Townsville. Also, I'd like to welcome from BCA, Michael Upton, from ABN, Reverend John Dean, from the Baptist Church of Gracemere, Sean Mills, from the Catholic Cathedral Parish, Sister Belle Amity, from the Peace Congregation, Pastor David Allen and his wife Marie. From the Salvation Army, Major Peter and Miriam Sutcliffe. From the Uniting Church Presbytery, Reverend Scott Walmont. From the Uniting Church on the south side, the Reverend Andrew Gillies. From the Queensland Police, the chaplain there, Glenn Lutet. And of course, not last, and certainly not least, Ms. Kim Harrington from Central Queensland University, who is the Associate Vice Chancellor there. And if I have forgotten any other honoured guests, my apologies. And of course, to everyone, our deepest and sincere welcome here to St. Paul's Cathedral today. We're now singing our first or our second hymn. It's a hymn of Christ, all glory be to Christ. And this hymn or at least part of it, was written for the reopening of the cathedral, which was just some 13 months ago.
Should nothing of our efforts stand, your legacy survive, unless the Lord does raise the house in vain, its builders strive. We pray St. Paul shall be a hope to justice and God's love.
Peter, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And Tom, and also with you. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. As administrator of this diocese, I ask you, Bishop Peter, are you prepared to take your place as our duly elected bishop?
I am, and I ask you all to pray to Almighty God that I may be faithful in fulfilling this office.
Before Dean Malusi speaks, I thought it would be nice if he's speaking on behalf of everyone at the cathedral, so if everyone from the cathedral parish might like to stand.
Bishop Peter,
As Bishop of Rockhampton, this cathedral will be your church and pulpit. We look to you to lead the chapter as it serves this cathedral. Are you ready to accept this responsibility?
Dean Melusi and the cathedral family, I am, and I seek your fellowship that together we may serve the people of this cathedral parish and love the people of this city.
Please be seated. I now ask all the clergy, incumbents of Central Queensland of Anglican Church, and also their lay leaders that are here representing all the parishes to stand. And together we say, as Bishop of Central Queensland, our parishes will also be your church and pulpit. We look to you to lead us and our congregations as we serve the people across our diocese. Are you ready to accept this responsibility?
I am. And I seek your fellowship and prayers that together we may serve the people of our congregations and love the people of Central Queensland.
Please be seated.
Where do you want me to go?
Thomas Henderson Brooks, Administrator and Archdeacon of the Diocese of Rockhampton, do induct you, Peter John Grice, into the possession of the Bishopric of Rockhampton with its responsibilities and opportunities of service. I place you in your seat in the Cathedral of St. Paul's.
Keep in mind that for a second. Thank you.
May grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be always with you, Peter. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I present to you the Right Reverend Peter John Grice, the 13th Bishop of Rockhampton.
Yes, please be seated. Friends, we're going to pause for a moment. Let us draw near to God with sincerity of faith and confidence that we worship a God of mercy and unfailing love. Please pray with me together. God of all mercy, we humbly admit that we need your help. We have wandered from your truth and way. We have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what is right. You alone can save us. Have mercy on us, wipe out our sins, and teach us to forgive others. Bring forth in us the fruit of your Spirit, that we may live the new life to your glory. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. And now hear the good news. God desires that none should perish, but that all should turn to Christ and live. In response to his call to acknowledge our sins, God pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe the gospel. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
Together the Gloria.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to the people on earth. Lord God, heavenly, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Almighty God, by your Son, Jesus Christ, you gave many excellent gifts to your apostles and commanded them to feed your flock. Bless your servant, Peter, called to the order of bishops. So fill him with your truth and clothe him with holiness, that as a pastor of your church, he may diligently preach your word and rightly teach your people to the glory of your name and the benefit of your church. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Living God, you made your church to grow through the zeal, courage, and unflinching witness of your servants, martyred in New Guinea. Give to us and all your people such steadfast faith in your good purposes that we may serve you faithfully wherever you have stationed us, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please sit.
This is the Old Testament reading from Numbers chapter 27, verses 15 to 23. Moses said to the Lord, "May the Lord, the God who gives breath to all living things, appoint someone over this community to go out and come in before them, one who will lead them and bring them in, so the Lord's people will not be like sheep without a shepherd." So the Lord said to Moses, "Take Joshua, son of Nun, a man in whom is the spirit of leadership, and lay your hand on him. Have him stand before Eleazar the priest and the entire assembly and commission him in their presence. Give him some of your authority so the whole Israelite community will obey him. He is to stand before Eleazar the priest, who will obtain decisions for him by inquiring of the Urim before the Lord. At his command, he and the entire community of the Israelites will go out, and at his command they will come in." Moses did as the Lord commanded him. He took Joshua and had him stand before Eleazar the priest and the whole assembly. Then he laid his hands on him and commissioned him, as the Lord instructed through Moses. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today
is Psalm 15. Please respond with the second half of the verse. Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? The one whose walk is blameless. Whose tongue utters no slander. Who despises a vile person, as those who fear the Lord. Who lends money to the poor without interest. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
The epistle reading from 1 Peter chapter 5 verses 1 to 11. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud but shows favour to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we sing this well-known hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
firm, and grace will lead me home. When weeping them 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first began.
Please remain standing for the Gospel reading.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John, chapter 21, beginning at verse 15. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Firstly, my very sincere thanks to Bishop Peter for this great honour in my life of being able to give the address here at his installation today. Also, my apologies too for the little bit of humming and sound. We're juggling more microphones than we normally would, and so thank you for those who have been working on that. Today is all about leadership. What makes a great leader? What characteristics, what qualities come to your mind when you think about a great leader? Is it someone who inspires us, who casts out a vision, who points the way forward? Is that what makes a great leader? Is it someone whom we can follow, who leads us by example, who rolls up their sleeves and gets their hands dirty? Is that what makes a great leader? Is it someone whose character is impeccable, who abounds in humility, grace, and love, who always respects others and treats all with dignity? Is that what makes a great leader? Is it someone who is amazingly gifted and talented, who knows what the organisation is all about, who thinks creatively outside of the box and problem solves? Is that what makes for a great leader? We're gathered here today in this cathedral, and also those watching online as well, are leaders from many spheres of influence. Politicians, local, state and federal, industry and business and community leaders, and church and international leaders as well. Now, even with my poor eyesight, I can stand here and I can recognise people amongst us who energetically give of themselves, who passionately serve for the betterment of our society, who make and do make personal sacrifices to improve our community. So what makes for a good leader, a great leader? Now, lots of things come to mind, I'm sure, for all of us, because we have all experienced good and bad leaders. Leaders who have impacted and affected our lives, whether it be on a personal level, or in the workplace, or in our local community, or leaders who have impacted and affected our lives from the national or even international level. All these leaders have affected our lives for better or for worse. And they've affected our lives for better or for worse by the words they have spoken or not spoken, and by the decisions that they have enacted or not enacted. Right now, the death toll in the USA from COVID is greater than the USA death toll from World War I and World War II and the Vietnam Wars combined. It stands at over 500,000 people, 506,000 yesterday when I looked. I'd say that their political words and decisions were for the worse. In contrast, in Australia, regardless of where your political allegiance might lie, I'd say that our political words and actions during COVID have been for the better. We've been blessed by wise political leadership at all levels of government. And I thank our politicians and leaders here for that. So what makes for good and bad leaders? Just over a week ago, I passed a personal milestone in my life. I've been ordained as an Anglican minister for 30 years. Yet, if I were 25 again today, hand on heart, I am not so sure that I would put my hand up to be an Anglican minister today. In the light of the Royal Commission, in the light of the abject failure of leadership in our Christian churches, where trust has been destroyed, where people have been abused and not loved, bad leadership is anathema to the good news. Bad leadership is contrary to Jesus, and it makes a mockery of God. However, 40 years ago, when I was young and wrestling with questions of meaning, life and purpose and faith, there were good leaders who inspired me, leaders who encouraged me, leaders who even, and I needed it, gently rebuked me. I was fortunate to have positive role models. However, I was still reluctant to become a leader because of the weight of responsibility that a leader has, and also at a young age I had stumbled across what I believed to be was the scariest verse in the Bible for anyone aspiring into leadership. James chapter 3 verse 1. Not many of you should become teachers or leaders, my fellow believers,
because you know that we who teach or lead will be judged more strictly. As soon as one steps into leadership, as I'm doing now, if we don't walk the talk, if our life is not one of integrity, we will be judged all the more strictly. There is an accountability, a higher authority who will be the judge of all we say and do. Many years later, I now find great comfort in that verse, for I know that what has been hidden in secret by unscrupulous leaders will one day be brought to light and judged by the God who sees all things and who knows all things. So, friends, what makes for good and great leaders? What characteristics and qualities have come into your mind? One of the main characteristics and qualities that come to my mind, and that I want to focus on just one, it's a one-point sermon, and I believe that it is essential for any great leader and essential for any great bishop. And I'm going to draw this characteristic out of our Bible readings. But I'd suggest that it applies to all leaders, whether you're a person of faith or not. And that essential quality is humility. Humility. Humility, I believe, is essential for any great leader. Our first reading was from the Hebrew Scriptures, from the book of Numbers, written some 3,500 years ago. And there we find that Moses is old. He's led the Jewish people for decades out of slavery in Egypt. And now, as a great mass of people, those 12 tribes of Israel, they're poised to take possession of the land. Land that God promised to them centuries before. Land that they had vacated centuries before. And land that was now occupied. And as Moses anoints Joshua, the leader who will lead the people into battle, into war, we don't find any military images of leadership. Instead, we find an agricultural image of leadership. Moses said to the Lord, "May the Lord, the God who gives breath and life to all things, appoint someone over this community to go out and come in before them, who will lead them out and bring them in, so that the Lord's people will not be like sheep without a shepherd." On the eve of battle, the leader that they needed was one like a shepherd. Now Moses had been born into slavery in Egypt, and the Jewish people there had become too numerous, so Pharaoh had ordered all baby boys to be killed. And Moses' parents were desperate, so they placed baby Moses in a basket and floated him down the Nile River as croc bait. But Moses was rescued by Pharaoh's daughter, and then raised as a son in Pharaoh's household. Yet, despite this privilege in education and preparation for leadership that he received, it was out in the desert where Moses met God, and where he learnt humility as a shepherd. You see, a shepherd protects their sheep. A shepherd nurtures their sheep. A shepherd leads their sheep to green pastures, to cool waters. A shepherd puts their body between the sheep and the wolf. A shepherd acts selflessly for the flourishing of the sheep. This is humility. And this idea of a leader being like a shepherd is a rich vein of truth that permeates all the way through the Bible. Like in Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul." Or like Jesus' words in John 10, "I am the good shepherd, and I lay down my life for the sheep." You see, a leader without humility is a dangerous person. Great leaders are not there in that position of leadership for themselves, or they should not be. They are there for the sake of others. Our Bishop Peter gets his name from the very first leader of the Christian church, the Apostle Peter, the fisherman who followed Jesus. Now we know that that Peter, nor ours, was not perfect. Now, when Jesus was before the authorities being interrogated and being flogged, Peter, the apostle, was outside around a campfire waiting for the outcome. "Aren't you one of Jesus' followers?" they accused. "No, I'm not," Peter lied. Three times around the campfire, Peter is questioned and accused. And three times he fails and denies ever knowing Jesus. Then the rooster crows, just as Jesus predicted. Peter realizes what's happened and he runs out of the camp, weeping bitterly. Then Jesus is crucified. And Peter is left feeling like a failed leader. And he wasn't alone. You see, earlier that evening, before Jesus had been arrested, he had said to his disciple these words, "This very night you will all fall away on account of me. For it is written," and he quotes from the Old Testament prophet Zechariah, "I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered." But then Jesus said, "But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." And it's at that point in the story that Peter makes his proud boast. "These guys might fall away, but I will never deny you. I will never desert you." Well, days after that first Easter day, Jesus' followers trekked the 100 or so kilometres north of to Galilee, back to their homeland. And they've taken the boat out fishing all night but caught nothing. And in the early morning light, a voice from the beach inquires, "Friends, have you caught no fish?" "No, we haven't," they answer. "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." And they did, and there's so many fish in their net that they're not able to lift it and haul it on board. And immediately the penny drops for the Apostle John, and he whispers to Peter, "It's the Lord." And as soon as Peter hears that, he jumps out of the boat and swims the 100 metres to shore to race to be with Jesus. And the others follow behind, lagging, dragging the haul of fish in the water because they can't get it aboard. Finally, they all meet up with Jesus on the beach with some fish and bread already on the barbecue. And Jesus tells Peter to go and help his mates haul in the fish. And eventually they're all around the campfire having had their fill of cooked fish and bread. And our gospel reading picks up the story at this point. Jesus addresses the issue of failed leadership with them all. He turns to Simon Peter and he says, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you," Peter replied. "Feed my lambs," Jesus said. And three times Jesus puts Peter on the spot with the same question, one question for each of Peter's three denials. And each time Jesus' instructions are slightly different to Peter. Feed my lambs, take care of my sheep, and feed my sheep. Quite simply, we find here the job description for a bishop. You see, the shepherd of the flock, symbolized by the bishop's crook that was presented to Bishop Peter on Wednesday evening in Brisbane. The shepherd, the bishop, the leader is there to feed my lambs. Jesus, we all belong to Jesus. And notice also the slightly different word for sheep. It's lambs, the very young. And so Bishop Peter, you are to nurture the faith of the young. And also those who are young in their faith and their belief. You feed them by teaching them all that Jesus commanded. You feed them by teaching us the word of God. Take care of the sheep, instructs Jesus as he reinstates Peter. Literally, Jesus says, shepherd the little sheep. In other words, pastorally care for them. Listen, support, heal, nurture, protect, shield, bind up the broken. Shepherd the sheep. And Jesus says, and feed my sheep. That means pointing us all to Jesus. That means basing your ministry upon his word and spiritually nourishing people with the gospel truth, which always challenges each and every one of us, where we proclaim that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. You see, being a godly leader is not about tickling itching ears. It is not about telling people what they want to hear. It is speaking the truth in love, because you love the truth. Now, a question for another time is the question that Pontius Pilate asked Jesus just before he had him crucified. What is truth? If that's a question that's on your heart and mind, then come and listen to Bishop Peter here in this building tomorrow morning at 7:30 or 9:30 a.m. as he starts his shepherding ministry in central Queensland. And we know that the Apostle Peter did take up the mantle of leadership and learned from his mistakes. One of our readings is from the letter he wrote a few decades later, and you can see that Peter has learned the necessity for humility in leadership. He writes these words, to the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over others, but who are entrusted to you, but being examples. All of you, writes Peter, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. Why? Because God opposes the proud, but shows favour to the humble. Humility is what makes a leader great. You cannot be a great leader without humility. And so, Bishop Peter, our prayer for you is that you will be a great leader, because you are a humble leader, a leader who is like our Lord Jesus Christ, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God and something to be used for his own advantage, but rather Jesus made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth.
Please be seated. We now come to that part of our service where Bishop Peter will be receiving some symbols of his ministry. So I'd like to invite Bishop Peter forward and also Archbishop Philip forward to start us off.
To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Peter, we ordained you as a bishop in the Cathedral Church of St. John on Wednesday evening in Brisbane. Receive the notarial act of your consecration. Be the shepherd of God's people in this diocese and point all towards our chief shepherd, our Lord Jesus Christ.
I will, God being my helper. Thank you, Peter.
All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness, so the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Bishop Peter, receive this Bible, teach us God's word and equip us for ministry.
I will, God being my helper.
I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God, our Saviour. Bishop Peter, receive this prayer book Pray with us and for us, for our leaders and all people, so that through our godly and holy lives, more people will be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth.
I will, God being my helper.
Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Bishop Peter, receive this map book of Central Queensland. Walk with us in ministry across Central Queensland. Journey with us in our lives. Be a loving and wise mission director for our diocese.
I will, the Lord being my helper. Thanks, Jim.
Physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. Bishop Peter, receive this exercise clothing. We will pray for your godliness as you lead us. And just as physical training is of some value, we ask you maintain your physical fitness, knowing its benefits for both mental and physical well-being.
Assuming there's no lycra, I will, the Lord being my helper. This one's a little trickier. Okay.
Together we all say, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bishop Peter, receive these traditional symbols of the office of bishop. Recall Jesus' warning to the teachers of the law when he said that they liked to footwalk around in flowing robes and loved to be greeted with respect in the marketplace. Be among us as one who came not to be served, but to serve. May these traditional symbols remind you of Jesus, our servant King, who died and rose for our forgiveness and eternal life.
I will, the Lord being my helper.
Please stand as we will now sing a hymn which is known as the Servant King.
Let us pray for the world and for the church. You may sit.
Eternal, holy, life-giving God, Father of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. We thank you for calling Peter Grice to be the 13th Shepherd, Overseer, Bishop of Rockhampton. We praise you for his presence among us. We thank you for the skills he has acquired and for the gifts you have bestowed on by your Holy Spirit. Guide and strengthen him in his service to you and the people of this diocese. We pray that he may be a shepherd after your own heart, who will always walk your ways and with loving care watch over your people faithfully, not only those who are part of your church, but also those you have chosen to bring into your kingdom. May he strive for all that is good, upright, holy, and disciplined. We pray that he will be a leader of vision and a teacher of the good news of your truths, as laid out in Holy Scripture. May he hold fast to the trustworthy message as it is written, so that he can encourage by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. May he not stray from your eternal truths, but always hold fast to your gospel of peace, love, and sacrifice as a true servant of Christ. Strengthen his passion to encourage people to know Christ and to make him known, and his desire to shape and enable the church to communicate the good news of Jesus Christ effectively. We pray that you will continue to bless him with the Holy Spirit, to give him courage to overcome the obstacles that he will encounter. Grant him wisdom in all choices for the building up of your church in central Queensland. We pray that wherever you lead him in this diocese, he will be accepted with love and affection as your chosen shepherd. We pray that your time here, Bishop Peter, with us, will be pleasing and rewarding. We ask you, merciful God, to grant our new Bishop, Peter Grice, humility and a servant's heart, so that with one mind and with one voice, we may together as the people of this diocese glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, will equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
And Lord God, we pray for Virginia, Matt, Tom, Freya, Mim and Eddie Grice. We thank you, Lord, for this family and pray that you will uphold and strengthen them in all that they do. We thank you, Lord, for your child, Virginia, that you called her into your church family and have guided her path to this day. We thank you that she has faithfully followed you and been willing to move away from family and friends to go on your journey, Lord, to this kingdom. We pray that you will bless her in Rockhampton in all that she is and all that she does. Give her a clear sense of how you would have her use her gifts in this place and to the days that you have ordained for her. Protect her heart as she loves her husband, her family, her church and her community. Comfort her in the times of loneliness and longing for her interstate children, family and friends. And grant her, Lord, the gift of godly and loyal friends in this, her new home. As well, Lord, we ask that you will grant her enjoyment and times of refreshment to rebuild her body and her mind. We pray too, Lord, for Eddie and Mim who have come on this journey to Rockhampton, that they will settle in this place, that you will grant them friends and encouragement for their faith. We pray too that you will nurture Tom, Matt and Freya, that you will comfort and protect them so far away as the reality of the family distance sets in. We thank you, Lord, for this, the Grice family. Grant them all a firm trust in you, love for each other, and accept your faith and everlasting love. Amen.
Let us pray for Rod Chisbell, as today marks his consecration and installation as Bishop of the Anglican Diocese of Armidale, a friend of the Grices and a friend of many others. Almighty God, who in your great love enabled us to call you Father, thank you for giving us all the necessary gifts so that we can function as part of your church. Today we especially thank you for Rod Chisbell, as you have called and equipped him to be the Bishop of the Anglican Diocese of Armidale. Continue to fill Rod with your truth and clothe him with holiness, that as a pastor of your church, he may continue to diligently preach your word, teach your people to the glory of your name and the benefit of your church. Fill Rod, merciful God, with grace and power, that he may always be ready to proclaim the good news of salvation through faith in Christ. Continue to fill his heart with love of you and your people, especially those in the Armidale Diocese. May he feed and tend to the flock of Christ as a good shepherd. Continue to give Rod humility and defend him from all evil, so that he may exercise without reproach the office of bishop, using its authority to heal and not to hurt, to build up and not destroy. Lord, continue to be with Jenny, his wife, as she supports Rod in this new role, and give her your discernment as she sorts out where her ministry will lie. Be with them both as they return to living in Armidale, especially as they become empty nesters, leaving Georgie behind in Tamworth. Lord, we thank you for these your servants, Rod, Jenny, Georgie, and their son Sam and his family. Bless them as they continue to serve you in new ways. Father, accept our prayer through your Son, Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit belong glory and honour, worship and praise, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty and eternal Father, we pray for our diocese. Lord, we lift up every single person, from our bishop to the least of the members of our church. None are least. They are all precious in your sight. But from the shores of the islands off the coast here in Rocky to the boundaries of the central western Queensland region, Lord, I pray that you will bind each and every one of us by a threefold cord that cannot be broken, that we will be strengthened in our weaknesses by your Spirit, that we will be led by our bishop and follow in the servant's footsteps that you have called him into, the shepherd, the servant shepherd. Father God, I ask and pray that we become faithful servants of Christ, that we are willing and ready to be led by his Spirit, faithfully reaching out to the communities in our diocese. I pray for the Central Queensland region, Father, for each and every community. You have called our region and every region a harvest field. Lord, you say that the harvest is ready, but how can anyone come out and harvest that crop if there are no willing workers, if there is no one to hear? So Lord, I ask for our communities and to open up our hearts, open up our minds, and open up our spirits, that each and every person in our community will be able to hear the gospel of salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray for the communities to be open and receptive to your words, to our willingness to serve them, whether they are Christian or not. We are there to serve them as you served us. Lord, we ask all of this in the mighty and powerful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come,
your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of fire, and deliver us from evil. Your kingdom, the power and glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. Now let's invite to come forward as we all extend our welcome to the whole family. You make it clap. You can do that. Thank you. Firstly, I'm going to, before we have some speeches in a moment, there's a few just little formal parts. And so I'm going to ask all of the clergy, Anglican clergy of Central Queensland, and also all of the members of our Anglican Church from across central Queensland to please stand and say these words of welcome to the whole family together. Peter, we welcome you as our bishop and pledge our support to you as our chief pastor. Peter, Virginia, Min and Eddie, we thank you for coming to central Queensland to serve. Matthew, Tom and Fran, we thank you for being willing to allow your family to be split so far apart. We will continue to pray for you all.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, we thank you for your support and prayers as we serve in ministry together.
Thank you. Please be seated. Now I'd like to invite all of the other representatives of the other local churches from Central Queensland and also members of any community organisations and community groups and levels of government, organisations like Anglicare and the Mission to Seafarers, etc., to stand and add their welcome to as well. Together.
Brothers and sisters, we thank you for your love and support as we serve our community together.
Thank you. Please be seated. And finally, I'd like to invite Archbishop Philip and actually all of our bishops and representatives from across the National Anglican Church and any other non-Central Queensland representatives that might be here to say and welcome with them as well.
Peter, we welcome you into your role as Bishop of Rockhampton. We look forward to working with you as colleagues.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, we thank you for your support and prayers as we serve in ministry together.
Thank you. Please be seated. Now we're going to have just a small selection of speeches. It won't be long. But I thought I might ask the Grice family, and you're welcome to keep standing if you want, or if you want to sit just for the speeches and then come up, because there'll be some gifts as well. Just sit with your family. Yeah. So our first guest that I'd like to invite up to officially welcome is Councillor Andrew Ireland. Andy, as we know him, who's the Mayor of the Livingston Shire Council. Our Mayor from locally in Rockhampton here was unavailable to be here today, sends his apologies. And so on behalf of all the local government, I'd like to invite Andy now to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom, and it's a privilege now. It's a privilege and an honour to be able to speak today. As I want to do, I try and find a word that kind of encapsulates what I'm feeling about occasions like this. And the word I came up with today was perspective. On a daily basis, brothers and sisters, we struggle with life, we struggle with work, we struggle with families, making time for all of that on top of community and on top of our faith. And I'm particularly delighted to welcome Bishop Peter, because I have no doubt that he will assist us in not only making sense of all of that, but also assisting us to ensure that God and our Lord Jesus Christ plays an important part in our life going forward. So on behalf of Livingston Shire Council, Bishop Peter, welcome to your new diocese, and we look forward to having many more occasions where we get to get together and have a chat. Thank you very much.
Now I'd like to invite Bishop Michael from the Catholic Church.
On behalf of all of the Christian denominations here and people of faith, to add his welcome. Thank you.
Firstly, Archbishop Phil of Aspinall, visiting bishops and clergy of the diocese, of the Anglican Diocese of Rockhampton, church leaders of Rockhampton, members of the Anglican Church, our civic leaders, brothers and sisters in Christ. Bishop Peter
and Virginia and your family. On behalf of the churches of Rockhampton and the Catholic Church, we welcome you. Welcome you to Rockhampton. I welcome you among us as the Bishop of the Anglican Diocese, and I pray all of God's blessings upon you as you begin your Episcopal ministry. We share similar jurisdictions, and I look forward to working with you and our fellow leaders as we cover the area of Central Queensland. It was in the time of our predecessors, Bishops Grinrod and Rush, that began something of a very special relationship between the Anglican Church and the Catholic Church. It happened here, in Rockhampton, and then continued when they both moved to Brisbane, and they formed what we call Queensland Churches Together. And now their successors, Archbishop Espinel and Archbishop Coleridge, continue that same wonderful relationship. And we do as Queensland bishops with you, the Anglican bishops, as we'll meet next Sunday night for tea. But we continue the tradition as the heads of churches in this area and move on the path of our churches together as we reflect on the great words of Jesus. May they be one as we are one. Bishop Peter, shepherd of your flock, may I share a few thoughts as a fellow shepherd. Even that the Venerable Tom did lots of wonderful thoughts, so thank you for that. My boss, Francis, invites us bishops to smell the sheep. Well, that's the wisdom of the bishop. So to get out and to smell the sheep, that is what we do. But yet, these are the words of wisdom that I received when I first began. And it talked about what a bishop does. The diocese of the bishop will sometimes go before the flock, his people, pointing the way and keeping their hope vibrant. Other times, he'll simply be in their midst with an unassuming and merciful presence. Other times, he'll have to walk behind, helping those who have fallen behind, and above all, allowing the flock to strike out on new paths. Bishop Peter, welcome. And may our time together be a wonderful time of cooperation, and as we work together, so out of the prayer of Jesus, may they be one as we are one. God bless you.
I'm Bishop Peter and the Grice family on behalf personally, and myself and Caroline, and also all of us in the Anglican Church in Central Queensland, we add our deepest welcome. Friends, it is exactly 1 year and 5 days since we all gathered in here, this cathedral, to lay down the bishop's staff when Bishop David retired. And so it was a great, for me, I felt very relieved as I passed that staff over. Thank you. As I said, I think when we announced it, it's like passing the ball out the back line, and you've now got that ball, that footy, and you're running with it. So praise God. I do also want to thank you. Over the last year, since we've known that you were elected, it's been my joy and privilege to every fortnight to spend an hour or so chatting on the phone and praying and getting to know Peter, and I've just really enjoyed that. And that's begun a friendship that I hope will continue for many years to come. I also want to publicly say that I don't want anyone to think that our decision to leave has anything to do with you coming. Yes, no, it's true. It's one of the sacrifices that we all make, and we have felt deeply, is for those of us who didn't grow up in this local area as we move here, is that we leave our family a long way apart. And so our children are living out, we're living at home with us when we responded to the God's call to come to Central Queensland, and it meant that they had to go and fend for themselves. And I know our son, he went through a period of couch surfing as he was homeless for a bit. And so that's a hard thing. And particularly in this last year of COVID, we felt that separation when we haven't been able to, you know, contact face to face. So please don't take our leaving in the next month or so off to Canberra. but I am looking forward to being a little bit cooler when I'm dressed in these robes. Also, I bring a welcome here from Peter and Christine Brain, the retired Bishop of Armidale, who is a mentor and friend to the whole Grice family. And I thought it was appropriate at this point to read these words out from them. Welcome if they're watching online. Peter, it is a great pleasure to bring you a greeting as you commence a new chapter in your pastoral life and ministry. We remember with joy and give thanks to our gracious Heavenly Father, your faithful ministry with Virginia in Inverell, and more recently in the West at Geraldton. Can I encourage you to maintain the same priorities in your Episcopal work as you did in your parish ministry, preaching the gospel so that individuals come to trust and serve Jesus, the centrality of the local church, with the diocese as the servant and promoter of these. By so doing, you will bring much encouragement to the believers in Rockhampton, be an example to the pastors and lay leadership, and be kept from being tied down by the minutia of office. Your own joy and strength will be found as you spend time in the scriptures and in prayer with your Father and fellowship with the pastors and congregations in your care. And above all, look for ways of commending and sharing the glorious gospel of your Saviour and Lord in the parishes of the diocese and among the people you will meet in Rockhampton. There is no greater way of showing the love of God than speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ in full reliance upon the Holy Spirit in both local churches and the community. Let the Apostle Paul have the final word. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Please persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. With our love and fellowship in Christ, Peter and Christine Brain. I'd now like to invite Archbishop Philip Aspinall, Archbishop of Brisbane and Southern Queensland, and also Archbishop of our province, to add his welcome. Thank you.
Peter, it's my privilege to welcome you to the province of Queensland and to your new role on behalf of the National Anglican Church of Australia. I was going to say welcome to Australia's newest bishop, but I think by now you're not. I hope you enjoyed your reign of, I think, 2 days and about 15 hours as Australia's newest bishop. But I want you to, in all humility, throughout your episcopal ministry, remind Rod Chiswell that he is your junior. It's my privilege also to welcome Virginia and Nim and Eddie, who have arrived in Rockhampton safely, but also to acknowledge Matt and Tom and Freya in Perth to complete studies. We know what a big ask it is of you to leave them behind, and we want them to know they're welcome in Rockhampton as often as they can come. With all present in the cathedral this morning and many others besides, we hope and pray and trust that your time in Rockhampton and Queensland will be fruitful and fulfilling and enjoyable in that order. Fruitful, fulfilling, enjoyable. Every diocese in Australia is unique and has its own challenges. In some respects, Rockhampton is a small diocese, relatively few stipendiary clergy, doesn't have vast financial resources or a large number of institutions, but that doesn't necessarily make its bishop's life any simpler or easier. In many ways, it adds challenges of its own. Rockhampton includes a significant proportion of Queensland. It's not small geographically, It requires substantial travelling on the part of its bishop and clergy. It faces all the challenges of ministry in rural and isolated communities, as well as the unique issues of mining communities, rural depopulation, years of prolonged drought, the shifting place of churches in Australian society in the 21st century. They all add to the difficulties and pressures faced in Rockhampton, not to mention perennial problems with buildings, even cathedrals. You will have plenty to do grappling with these realities. And what we entrust to you doesn't stop there. As a diocesan bishop in the Anglican Church of Australia, particularly perhaps at this time in its history, our expectations and hopes of you as a bishop in the broader context loom large. We need you to give as much as within you lies to strengthening the church and furthering its share in Christ's mission. When tempers are frayed and relationships strained, we need you to be a peacemaker, a bridge builder, a guardian of truth and unity, a minister of healing, wholeness, and reconciliation. If you run out of things to do, just give me a call. Meanwhile, we very much look forward to receiving through you all that God has to give us. And I just interrupt myself for a moment to say, Archdeacon Tom, how much the province has appreciated your leadership and service during what has been probably a longer than usual interregnum. You've been a great person to work with, and we thank you very much for all you've done. Please join me in thanking Tom. Thank you. Peter, Virginia, Eddie, Matt, Tom and Freya, you're all very welcome in Queensland as you, Peter, take up your new role as Bishop in the province and in the National Church. Welcome.
Peter, Virginia, Newman, and Eddie, there's one final welcome, which is from the kids, the young people of Central Queensland. It's on our video. We don't really have the tech to do it well in here, so it's been given to you personally. It's been put together by the great guidance of the Reverend Philip Vance Spiker, as they put a video together for you guys when you were still in WA. It will be attached to the end of this live stream, so if you want to catch it, it'll be there straight away and played, and you can go and have a look at it afterwards. That's from all the kids as well. I'd now like to invite you to come forward again, and there are some small gifts and presentations. It's mainly for Virginia, Mim and Eddie, because Peter's been received a lot already. Thanks, Colin. Can we all join together and give them one huge round of applause? I invite you to respond. Thank you.
We'll be brief.
For the first time in history, my family want me to respond on their behalf. So the first thing is the obvious response of thank you, simply that. Thank you for all who came, all who watched, all who prayed, thank you. For those who've travelled, thank you. For those who will be ongoing friends to us, thank you. Now, we've decided that Rocky is a really great place and we've received a great welcome. So there's your generalised thank you. I thought I'd fine-tune it by doing four what I've described as vignettes of gratitude. Okay, so four of them. First, vignette of gratitude. Vignette of gratitude number one. I want you all to turn to the back page of your service outline and just scan through the number of people who are listed there. This does not happen without a lot of people doing a lot of stuff. So Tom's already has his accolade, but well done. To the Dean, Dean Melissa in the Cathedral family, thank you. Now this is the important one. See where it says admin support at about 0.8 down the page? I'm not going to call them the Golden Girls because they'll kill me, but they're my girls who work with me. So Jim, Barb, Tara. When it says admin support, that means everything, okay? So thank you for everything you've done. So actually, why don't we clap them? Savour the moment, ladies. Move on. I'll see you at 8:30 in my office for morning prayer. Thank you. Right, that was vignette of gratitude number one. Vignette of gratitude number two. Our Archbishop said on Wednesday, it is time to bring down the barriers. That is a sentiment I utterly endorse. However, I would also add there is also time to erect barriers, particularly when you own a Labrador and a Beagle. So to Bob the Builder Witten and the Fencing Boys, thank you. Vignette of gratitude number three. Our elder daughter Freya, who's in Perth, she gave us strict instructions at our consecration to be, and I quote, the hottest clergy family at the consecration. For my part, I think I've succeeded. Let me finish. Thank you to Gary Nelson, my bishop, who threw open the vault at Holy Cross Cathedral, Geraldton, to extract Bishop Witt's cope and mitre. So thank you, Bishop Gary, and thank you for coming over. I would also like to thank Dean Chris Chataway of Perth, who set up a fund to fund the rest of the bishopric gear. Now, why am I telling you this? Well, I was actually blown away on Wednesday night to see the number of bishops and deans who made the trek to Brisbane. Now, of course, we have a righteous remnant now of the deans and bishops, but I was so touched by that. So I'm very grateful for that. Vignette of gratitude number four. I want to say thank you to the Fletchers. So the Fletchers were sitting down the front here. They came to serve in Rockhampton. Steve left a job as a deputy principal of a school. Penny left a job as a school counsellor. Essie and Belle, they left friends and school and peer groups, and they've come to work with us. Just cop that for a second. Thank you, Fletchers. Let's give them a round of applause. My final word is a thank you, but it's also a message. The message is, the Diocese of Central Queensland, we are open for business. We have work to do, so let's get on with it, because our communities need Jesus. So praise God, from whom all blessings flow. And one of those blessings is food, fellowship and fun, which Tom is about to tell us what's going to happen next. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. That is my final duty to just some things at the end. So firstly, we're going to be serving some refreshments immediately after the service in the hall just across the way. Because it's deemed as a separate location, you will need to re-sign in, just get out those little smartphones, turn them back on, and use the QR codes. There's two rooms where there's going to be food served in the hall. Please just notice the limit of numbers in those two areas and stick to that and follow the instructions of those on the doors. Also, because of COVID, all the food and things like that will be given to you. So you're not there making your own tea, you'll be receiving it. So all the clergy, because we're minimising the maximising the numbers that we can have in the space, I have volunteered all of the Anglican clergy and our diocese to be the ones serving, just a reminder to them, so they'll be serving on the food. So please follow their instructions. And I figure that they are where people should be completely up to date with all the COVID rules. If you feel like you would like to contribute to the ministry of this parish, the cathedral and the diocese here, there is a freewill offertory in the baskets as you leave this afternoon. And also you're more than welcome to join the cathedral congregation and the others tomorrow at 7:30 a.m. and 9:30 a.m. here as Bishop Peter preaches and presides here in the cathedral for the first time. And may I add my thanks to all the people in the back of the booklet. I think that is all from me. So, the blessing.
Would you please stand? Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted, honour all people, love and serve the Lord. Rejoice in the power of the Holy Spirit, and may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
So now we shall go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.
Hi, my name is Zach.
Hi, Mim and Eddie. I'm Tabitha.
Hi, my name's Ella.
Mim and Eddie.
I'm Aaron.
I'm Ryan. Welcome to Central Queensland.
My name is Jess Bermant Spiker.
Hello, my name is Otto.
Cool, I'm Bat a Rat.
And a hot tip for living in Yipoon is not to wear a jumper.
A hot tip for living in Central Queensland is that you can go to the Rockhampton Zoo.
A hot tip for living in Queensland is to go down to the beach at every opportunity.
A hot tip for living in Central Queensland is swim at every chance you get.
I have a few tips for you for living in Central Queensland. Number one is Central sunscreen. Another thing is the legendary water bottle. The next thing is floppy hat.
A hot tip is to know that you can swim.
A hot tip for living in Central Queensland are the kippers. From a distance, you can see them. They're really good.
My tip for living here is to only wear thongs because they're the superior form of footwear.
Yeah, my tip is there's not too much rain, but make sure to always have your rain gauges just so you can compare how many mils of water you got.
Yeah. We hope you guys settle in well.
Don't forget stuff for the road trips.
I will be praying that you will not listen to anyone who tries to stop you following Jesus, but you will continue to serve him every day.
We hope you make new friends.
Stop.
Don't get stung by a jellyfish.
I hope you make new friends.
I'll be praying for you to love God with everything and love your neighbour as yourself.
And I pray that God will help you to make new lifelong friends in Queensland and that you will acclimatise to the Queensland weather.
And we'll be praying for you that you will keep following Jesus.
Praying for you is that you will make friends and settle in very well.
And we're going to be praying for you that you make many good friends as you transition into
Central
life.
Central Queensland.
It's Central Queensland. Yeah.